biologist by background who studies infectious disease dynamics, which he'll be talking about today. He taught at Northwestern. Prior to returning to Berlin, he's done some cognitive science, some work with random walks. He's very well known in the complexity community for these really awesome explorables, which are, you know, like testimonial inspiring, and he's nice enough to be working with us here this week discussing how we can incorporate some of that interactivity and, you know, sort of use some of the explorables for SFI's education and communication. And one thing you might not know about Dirk is that his work was the subject of a crime show called Numbers, because he wrote a paper called Where is George that tracks human movement based on dollar bill serial numbers. And that was picked up by a crime show about a mathematician who solves murder mysteries. So without further ado, yes. Here's Dirk.
All right. Thank you, Jenna. And thank you very much for having me here again. So last time I was here at the Institute was about 10 years, a little over 10 years ago. And I think at that time I was actually talking about this study that we did with the Where's George website data. And it was also related to disease dynamics. So today I'm going to talk to you a little bit about my research. And not about the complexity explorables, which I would like to mention though. If you get bored during the talk, you can get out your cell phones and then play with the complexity explorables instead. So just a quick note, it's just a website called complexityexplorables.org, and on this site you will find things that I've been making for the past 2 years. Essentially, the motivation behind this was for teaching. So in Berlin, I'm in the biology department and I teach a course on complex dynamic phenomena in biological systems. And I felt that it really helped a lot to have interactive online tools for the students to explore these phenomena and get an intuitive, an intuition about this. And so this is how this this site emerged, and it's also a project that distracts me from doing research. Like whenever I get stuck with my research, I just go ahead and make an explorable, because then at the end of the day, I have done something that I could look at. But so today I'm going to talk to you a little bit about my research, and it's a little bright in here. Can I just turn this down? That doesn't, well, can we turn it down a little further? Okay, so what you see here is, if it works, which it doesn't, let me go back one more time. Here we go. So this is a video clip about, it shows a computer simulation of the H1N1 pandemic in 2009. So most of my talk will be about systems like this. I will tell you a little bit about how we can understand these phenomena using network theory, how we can develop computational models that can make predictions about this on a large scale and on the H1N2. So in the systems that I will be discussing, networks play a role. And there are essentially two types of networks that play a role. One is shown here. If I find my mouse, here we go. So in the first part of the talk, I'll be discussing a phenomena that occur on a global scale, so that are driven by this, for instance. This is the global air transportation network. And it's just also a video animation that is just to convey that we're very connected in the 21st century. So there are connections on all scales, and that has an impact on how things spread on a global scale. And then there are other types of networks also that play a role in disease dynamics. This is such a network. It's a network derived from actual data. In this network, the dots are individuals, and the links are quantify the amount of time they spend together in physical space. And I will talk a little bit more about this data set and who measured this, but you can see there are like clusters in it, there's structure in it. And one of the things we're trying to do is we're trying to understand what kind of features of these networks have an imprint or an impact on the way that diseases or contagion processes evolve on these structures. So let me go back here. Yes. The color, I'll talk about this in a minute, like at the end of my talk. So the color is just a grouping. So the network, I will discuss more in detail later. But I just wanted to convey that there are some networks that are transportation networks, where the nodes are locations and links are this mobility or traffic flux. And then there are other networks where the nodes are individuals and links are contact durations or other things that are important for disease dynamics. So there are more types of networks that play a role, but this is a transportation network. Talk about this in the first part of my talk, and this, what I just showed you, are networks between individuals. So let me first talk about the global scale. One of the things that that I do at Humboldt, part of my position is also at the Federal Public Health Institute, which is called the Robert Koch Institute, which is kind of like the CDC for Germany. And for that institute, we develop models for disease dynamics. So the epidemiologists and public health people, they would like to know if there's an outbreak, you know, what kind of countermeasures do we have to do, what kind of policies have to be put in place. And whenever there's something new, like the Ebola crisis a couple of years ago in West Africa, the epidemiologists there are interested in what is the import risk, what is the risk for Europe, how do we contain it in the West African countries, and what could we do. Now, I'm going to start with a slide of two movies that some of you may have seen. Who has seen this one, Contagion? A few people only. Okay, this is actually a pretty good film because in this movie, a very important parameter is mentioned, R0, which is the basic reproduction number. It's the only film that that I know that discusses, or where sort of a global pandemic scenario is played out, and where they actually mention this parameter, which is interesting. I also mentioned it because some of it was shot near Chicago when I was living there, so that was interesting. More interesting is this one, The Rise of the Planet of the Apes. Who has seen this one? Okay, and so who has not seen it? Okay, now I'm gonna do a spoiler, so you may want to cover your ears. At the end of this film, it is explained why there are so many apes on this planet and so very few humans. And when you, and the story is this, they, you know, the bad company, they develop a virus, and that virus infects humans, and there's this pilot, he gets infected, and then he travels the world, infects others, and you know, it's a deadly virus. And at the end of this film, you see this animation, which kind of illustrates the way this sort of contagion, this dangerous virus, spreads across the globe. And it's actually quite simple. When I saw this movie in the movie theater, I looked at this and I thought, oh, this very much looks like some of the simulations we do and other people do that try to understand global disease dynamics. And at the end of the film, you'll see it's very reminiscent of some of the simulations that people run for these kind of phenomena. So let me, I just wanted to mention this because I thought this was quite interesting, because they really put some effort into this animation here at the end of that film. Now, when we develop these kind of models that try to make these predictions there, and you know, from a physicist's point of view, trying to kind of focus on the things that all these phenomena share, we're interested in essentially two simple questions. Like, if there is an outbreak, say Ebola in West Africa, or a new bug in South America, we would like to know, where is it going to go next, and when is that going to happen? So there are more questions than these two, but these are the simplest ones one can come up with initially. It's also usually what public health people ask themselves first. Now, when you have a simple contagion process, this is a simple sort of agent-based lattice system for a disease that starts in the center, and then pixels in this, they can be infected and can infect neighboring pixels. So there's sort of the local proliferation, and it's only local local interactions, and then quite generically you have a propagating wave, and because of the symmetries of the system it pretty much looks like a circle. And that's nice, because if that's the case, then if I'm the green dot, I can just sort of measure the speed of this wave, and I know the distance to the origin, and then I can pretty much compute very accurately the time that it will take to reach me. So that's nice. It's like, throwing a rock into the water and seeing the ripples spread, and if I just measure the speed, I can make predictions. And it's quite generic, of course. Those of you who have know something about reaction diffusion systems, where you have sort of local exponential proliferation and diffusion in space, you generically get these propagating waves like the Black Death that spread across Europe in this almost wave-like pattern, which took about a couple of years and propagated a few kilometers every day. But if you just take this simple system and start this, how do I start it? I wonder if I have to press this. Yeah, it's now only starting the wrong one. Let me try to figure out how, what I have to press, maybe space. All right, so the left one doesn't work. That's the old one, where you have a propagating wave. And the right simulation is just exactly the same, except for every now and then there's a long-range interaction, so a local infected pixel can infect a distant pixel, and it's intuitive, and it's what one would expect, that the pattern looks more spatially incoherent. There are new sort of outbreak locations, etc. It looks more complicated. But the consequence is that, of course, when I'm, say, at this location, it is very difficult for me to make a prediction when that wave is going to hit me, just based on the geometry of the system, because it's more complicated. And that is just because there's long distance, mobility involved. And when we look at the air transportation network, we can just see by the geometry of this, there's, of course, the majority of trips are short distance, but there's also lots of long-range mobility happening. And if you just look at the numbers a little bit, it's good to look at the numbers to develop an intuition about, what this network is. We have about 4,000 airports in it, about 25,000 directions, about 3 billion passengers per year, and about 14 billion person kilometers per day. So that's what humanity travels every day. These are just passengers, yeah. So they're not unique passengers. Otherwise, it'd be like half the human population. So, this is an interesting number. I think it's good to look at these numbers. So it's 14 billion kilometers, which is like three times the radius of our solar system, if we don't include Pluto. So it's a long, there's massive stuff happening on this network. A little scary, I think, if you look at the numbers. And what you can do now is you can use these networks and put them into the core of a computer simulation. I will discuss this in a minute, what the math is behind this. This is just, again, to illustrate to you that what we also observed in the sort of abstract pixel model, you can also see in a computer simulation here for H1N1. It starts somewhere, there's some sort of local stuff going on, but very quickly it spreads everywhere. And more quantitative, this is a little bit, here's data. This is H1N1, this is SARS 2003. This is a computer simulation for a hypothetical disease that starts, say, in Hong Kong. You can either look at the data or look at the computer simulated scenario and measure the geographic distance or correlate geographic distance to the outbreak location to the arrival time of an epidemic. And you can see there's a correlation. Obviously, the further you are away, the less likely or the longer you have to wait until this wave hits you. But there's a lot of variation in it, right? So if I'm, say, 10,000 kilometers away from an outbreak location, there's a variation for something like a flu-like pandemic between 60 and 160 days. So there's, the geographic distance no longer is a good predictor of the arrival time. One can put a line in here and then see, for instance, like H1N1 or similar diseases spread at around 250 to 400 kilometers a day, but that number doesn't tell you much because the cloud is so scattered. So one of the approaches that people take is they develop mathematical models. We do that too. Here's a simple version of this in which they incorporate the transportation network into the model. So there's usually the model consists of a local dynamical system that governs the disease at a local scale. And then there's a passenger flux that couples these places. So it's a metapopulation kind of approach. And the data that goes into the model is derived from actual data of passengers or passenger fluxes. Here's a little bit of the math that is involved in a simple version of such a model, where we have a local dynamical system that governs the disease dynamics at a local scale, and there's this matrix PNM, which is derived from the traffic flux between different locations. And the actual, and one can fit these parameters to that are involved in the simple model, in the simple model, to actual measured parameters, and then one can run a simulation. Actual ones that are used in making predictions about, say, H1N1 or similar, or Ebola, are a little bit more complicated. There's stochasticity involved and random factors and a lot of more structure. So, but this is the philosophy that many people have. They try to develop computational models in which they plug in mobility networks, not only air transportation, but also on a more local scale. And so one of the most prominent systems that people are using nowadays is GLEAM, which it's a system developed by Alex Vespignani, Vittoria Kulica, and others, a large team. And this is kind of, is following this philosophy of trying to develop a computational system that incorporates all sorts of data on a very high resolution level, everything that you know, the researchers can get their hands on in terms of, say, age distributions at a given city or hospital concentration or hospital beds. Everything is put into this, and it's a client-server kind of system, so it's a very complicated simulation framework. And so this is sort of the high-end stuff that is happening in this field. And whenever there's an outbreak, like Ebola a couple of years ago, you will see that there are papers coming out that are trying to make predictions about the future time course. And they're based on systems like GLEAM or variants of this sort of technology. Now the problem is, even though these models are pretty good in terms of making predictions for a couple of weeks, for certain scenarios, and scenarios where they're most needed, they don't work so well. And the reason for this is all of these models are, or you know, many of these models are dynamical systems. So what they need when there's an outbreak, they need information about the initial conditions and parameters of the system. And precisely during, when there's an outbreak, something new is happening, like Ebola in West Africa, not much is really known about the local situation. So the initial conditions are not clear. Or, there's lots of variation in terms, on the information about this. Often there's a new virus involved, or an older virus in a new context, so people don't know the parameters, like transmission rates or recovery rates, or, it's a different climate situation. And the parameters are often not known. And the problem here is that both of these pieces of information need to be known in order to make reliable predictions. And the more complex such a prediction machine is getting, the more parameters are there, and the finer the resolution has to be for the initial conditions. And that's an issue, I think, and some people disagree. I believe it is an issue. When you look at, for instance, these two papers, these are two papers that appeared in Nature in 2006. This was kind of the onset of using high-performance computing on a large scale agent-based simulations for, in this case, for a hypothetical pandemic in Thailand and the United States by the same authors. And these papers are like 4 to 5 pages long, extremely highly detailed agent-based simulations. And when you read these papers, this is what I tell my students often, you know, take the PDF and count the word assume. Yeah? And then you get in these four pages or five pages 18 and 17. And that's a problem, because these are not assumptions like we're going to assume humans are like particles, which is also an assumption, but it's sort of more an abstraction. These are assumptions about actual numbers that are required for the simulation. And so you have to either make an assumption or make, and there are like, say, 20 parameters, and there's a variance, and even like the most sophisticated computer simulations can then not be systematically analyzed. And so their robustness, it's unclear how robust these simulations are. And that's a problem, I think. There's a great paper that I mention in almost all my talks. Some of you may know this. It appeared in 2004 by Bob May, who at that time I think was still president of the Royal Society, about the uses and abuses of mathematics in biology. And one has to say that Bob May was among the pioneers of like in computational or mathematical epidemiology, or like the revival of this theme or this topic.
Question.
And the yes.
So obviously they can't do anything even approaching a complete sensitivity analysis. Are you doing partial ones, or what?
They do. So it depends on the paper that you look at. So some people do a little bit of variation in some of the parameters, which induces then a variation in their results. And quite often when they make predictions about the time course, Ebola is a great example. Then there, you know, they plot this on a log-log scale, and there's a huge, you know, orders of magnitude in their predictions, and that's not very helpful. And it's not done in a systematic way. Often it's also hidden. You cannot really tell what they do, especially when it appears in Nature, and it's totally not visible what is happening in these situations. So. About this paper, I loved it when I read this. I'm just going to quote a few things from this paper, which I think is great. The increasing speed and sophistication and ease of use of computers enables an increasingly large number of life scientists who have no substantial background in mathematics to explore mathematical models and draw conclusions about them. And he quotes mathematical models. And he says, such activity usually consists of representing sensible and evidence-based assumptions as the starting point for a complicated and usually nonlinear dynamical system, assigning particular parameters, often in an arbitrary way, and that is actually happening, and then letting this complicated system rip. So it's kind of like a mixture of qualitative and quantitative. It's mixed in this weird way in many studies. We arguably are seeing an increasingly large body of work in which sweeping conclusions, emergent phenomena, are drawn from the alleged working of a mathematical model without clear understanding of what is actually going on. I think this can be worrying. And I like this very much because it's, you know, I work with computers a lot, and I write computer simulations, and I know exactly that it is tempting to, you know, put a lot more detail into it just because the computer can do it. And there is certainly a tendency in the modeling community, at least in the infectious disease modeling community, that is sort of following this idea that the more detail I put in, the better the predictions are going to be. But I'm not so convinced. But there is, because of computing and because of machine learning and artificial intelligence and you know, massive data that is now available in epidemiology, there's also another approach to this, which is called nowcasting. So there's, for instance, this healthmap.org where people set up this website where they can collect incidences of all sorts of infectious diseases, also vector-borne diseases. It's a great website. And then some you may have heard of Flu Trends, which was very popular a couple of years ago, where people just, you know, use web searches or Google and slight statistical variations in specific search terms in order to make predictions about, say, seasonal influenza or something. So that's sort of the other approach that is taken, where we now have massive data on a very high resolution on infectious diseases, also about host behavior, like our mobility on a very fine scale, contact patterns, all of this is kind of revolution, you know, it's like a revolution in computational epidemiology or in epidemiology as such. And many people take this data, and it's also very high dimensional and complicated, and using statistical models is another approach where it's not so much focused on the mechanism, just making predictions based on what is in the data. And like these terms like big data analytics and machine learning, statistical inference are like related to this. And so that's another approach where we say that more data does better statistics, and you know, we have complicated algorithms that can extract hidden features in the data. That's also a philosophy, but that also has certain drawbacks. You may have heard about this website or book. I by chance discovered this in a book in like one of the English bookstores in Berlin. It's called Spurious Correlations. It's a tiny little book, and I looked at this and I thought, oh, this is funny. And this guy did funny things. So he just superimposed curves that had nothing to do with one another and computed their correlation. So for instance, the sociology doctorates versus the worldwide non-commercial space launches. And obviously there's a large correlation, and you can hit there many of them. This is my favorite one. Margarine consumption versus the divorce rate in Maine with a correlation coefficient of 0.98. So it's always a little tricky also, you know, obviously all of you know this, but in spite of the fact that many people know this sort of difference between correlation and causation, it's very tempting, especially in epidemiology, to confuse the two. Here's an older paper, which I by chance discovered, which is about this. So this is an actual scientific paper. It's called On the Laws of Pestilence. It was published in 1865. The guy is a medical doctor. And in this paper, he actually argues that large-scale epidemics have something to do with the constellation of the planets. And he has tables in this article. And it makes, like, from interpreting these tables about constellations of planets and stars, it makes total sense to infer this. And he actually says the simultaneous appearance of epidemic diseases in several places of the Earth's surface, its continuous and progressive march in a somewhat straightforward direction, show that it owes its origin to cosmical and not to local causes. So this was before germ theory, and you know, it made total sense from the data analytics side that the guy did. I thought this was great. So let's go back to this simulation and see if, I don't know why these videos keep not working. Yes. Yeah, it makes total sense, yeah. So let's look at this again. So if we're now in a situation where we can run these computer simulations, and but you know, maybe we can understand the system much better in a sense that we can understand, say, a uniform reaction diffusion system better. So I paused this video in the middle, and you can see sort of the spatially incoherent pattern. And the reason, you know, almost all videos that you will see on like disease dynamics on a geographical large, you know, scale will have this kind of features. They all look a little different, but you know, it's complicated. And so then a while back we figured maybe we have to change our perspective. Like, what does the system look like if we are the pathogen? When we look at these maps, like the world map or a map of the US and a computer simulation in Europe or whatever, we look at these maps because we're used to these maps. That's what, you know, people developed these maps because they made sense, because geographic distance makes sense. And one of the things that we tried, and I'm going to explain this to you in a second, is we try to change this. Let's say you take the Worldwide Air Transportation Network and you are here at JFK in New York. And then you will find in the data on air transportation that there are lots of people traveling to London and to Frankfurt. Very few people, compared to that, travel to, say, Pittsburgh or Raleigh-Durham in North Carolina. So potentially, like, if you're a pathogen and you're like, you pick a random person on this airport that you're that is your host, then you're more likely to end up in London and in Frankfurt. So why not define a new type of effective distance that takes this into account? It's very straightforward, and it's an old idea, actually. But it has never been applied in this context. So maybe when you're a pathogen, London is much closer, and Frankfurt too, and these geographically closer locations are far away. And one can, there are different ways of translating this intuition. More traffic is closer, and less traffic is far away. One of the things that for which we have an underlying theory is this definition of an effective distance from J to I. It's 1 minus the log of the probability of traveling from J to I. And that, I will explain that in a second, that is related to most probable paths of a random walk happening in this network. But as such, we can just impose it, and the intuition is more traffic closer. Now, when you have that, you can ask in a simple network, say this is your network and it has sort of weighted links, you can ask what is the shortest path from this location to this location. So it could be this one, but it could also be that one, using this effective distance. So the more traffic, the shorter these links are. And when you do that, you can, from every location, say from this one, compute the shortest path tree, which is a tree network, which tells you the shortest path from, say, this location to all the other locations. Now you can do that with the actual data. Say you are in, I think this is New York, and you can compute the shortest path tree from New York to every of the other 4,000 airports in the network. And then you can draw it, but that doesn't show much. It's just this, you know, a subset of all the links in the network, but it doesn't do much. But what you can do is, let me move here, I think. Nope, it's here, probably. So here's a little interactive illustration of what happens if you do this. I picked out Tegel Airport, which is Berlin, one of the Berlin airports, not the new one, which isn't done yet. And now I can rearrange the all the airports from my perspective in Berlin. And here the radial distance is now this effective distance to all the other locations, okay? And the tree that you see is this shortest path using this effective distance. So intuitively it's clear, Frankfurt is pretty close, so is London Heathrow, but also Chicago is not so far away. Or Beijing, and you can also, let's now take Albuquerque, ABQ, where's the Q? You would think, so it's close to Los Angeles and Dallas and Houston. Through Houston, I flew here. So it's mostly American airports that are sort of in the inner ring. That's a fun game, but what you can also do, which is more important for disease dynamics, let's say you pick an airport in West Africa. Trying to find it here, Conakry, okay? Conakry is in Guinea, and it's one of the countries that was affected by Ebola. And then you can look at the tree again. And you can see that, you know, there are African airports like Dakar and Casablanca. They're fairly close, but one of the closest is actually Paris-Charles de Gaulle, right? Because there's lots of traffic. It's a former French colony. So, and that's also the gateway to the rest of the world. So most of the shortest connections to the rest of the world go through that place. Interestingly, if you take an airport, let me see, it's very hard to, I may get it. Is it this one? Nope. Freetown. So Freetown is in Sierra Leone, which is very, a neighboring country, was also affected by Ebola, but here we have the London airports that are very close. Why? Because that's a former British colony and there's still strong connections. So even though these airports are very similar and close to one another, they have a very different structure in terms of, like, if a pathogen is on a host in that location, it takes a different, very different route to other places in the world. Okay. Yeah. Yes.
Like, you just take the first or like the most busy connection.
Well, if I look at the shortest, say, I'm taking a reference node, okay? And then to every other node, there's one unique shortest path, okay? If I use this effective distance. So it's not like counting the number of steps, but this effective distance that is computed by the probability.
Right.
So, yeah? That's true. That's a very good point. And like when I showed you this initially, the idea there were three papers, one that is only based on the shortest paths, it's an approximation. And the next paper, and we did include a series of other paths in computing sort of the probability of going from A to B. And it turns out, it's a little bit of a detail, when these networks are very inhomogeneous and very strongly inhomogeneous, then everything is dominated by the shortest path. And I'll show you some evidence for this in a second.
It's like a variation of the
A little bit, yes. So this is, so far, it's only a fun way of interpreting this, but it does have an impact if we run simulations. So here are two simulations. So hypothetical pandemic diseases, on the top row, it's a hypothetical disease that starts out in Atlanta and here on a Greek island. So two randomly chosen places, essentially. And on the left, you see the exact same simulation, except for in a representation that uses this effective distance. And what is complicated here becomes sort of a concentric spreading pattern. There is variation in it, and there are reasons for this, but to a good approximation, this looks like a concentric spreading pattern. And what this means is there are two things that I want to mention. A, it's related to your question. Now, this structure is only computed by the most probable paths of a random walk. And because it almost looks concentric, it looks like it is dominated. It's okay to leave off everything else, and everything is dominated by this path structure. And it's the same, or it works for every location in the system, like this one and that one. The circles look different, the trees look different, but there is a concentric wave. It also means that if you can do this, if you are, say, in this location, and you measure the speed of this, you can make a fairly accurate prediction of when this wave will hit you. And so, like coming back to this original picture where we had a correlation of arrival time and geographic distance, the most straightforward thing to do is now to replace this geographic distance by this effective distance. And this is then what happens is that not only in the computer simulations is everything kind of squished onto this sort of linear relation here, but also if you just plot the actual data of like H1, N1, and SARS, there are more fluctuations. There's also a huge variation in the accuracy of the measurement on the arrival time, but it is much better than if you just use geographic distance. So it is a helpful tool. From more abstract point of view, you know, these are again a bunch of sort of outbreak locations, and this correlation of arrival time and effective distance, it means that, you know, the arrival time can be split into two different things. One is this effective distance from the outbreak location, which only depends on topological features of the network, and the speed, like the slope at which this is happening, depends on all the dynamic quantities like recovery rate, invasion threshold, R0, etc. So the slope may change, but that's a helpful insight that the arrival time again can be split into a distance and a velocity, and these depend on different parameters of the underlying system. And so one of the things that we also did is, you know, we used this in real data and also the sort of hypothetical computational models, but we also used it in like the most sophisticated models that exist, and it works in those also well. Another insight from this is that, you know, when this, you know, this insight that everything looks concentric, if you look at the disease from the outbreak location using effective distance, one of the things that is also true is that only from this location it looks like a concentric pattern. So let's say, this is the basic idea. Let's say we have a picture like in the top left, we have a spread out snapshot, temporal snapshot of a spreading phenomenon. it could be in any kind of system. Here I'm using sort of a hypothetical pandemic snapshot. And now let's say we have 10 candidates for outbreak, or 12 for outbreak location. I could now I could also use all of them, but you know, just to make it fit the screen here. And then I look at the outbreak, the pattern that I see here from the perspective of all of the candidates. And some are kind of concentric, some are a little scattered, etc. And there's one that is the smallest circle with the least variation. By variation, I mean like this thickness. One can quantify this, but you can also see it in this illustration. And that is then the actual outbreak location. And one can do this in a systematic way, and then one can show that with a high probability you can reconstruct the outbreak location based on the pattern that you see. There are many factors that are involved, but it works well. And now I'm going to ask you how am I doing for time?
Have you done this for HIV?
No, we have done it for EHEC, actually, which is a foodborne disease that was an issue in 2011. And in Germany, where people tried to find the source of this foodborne disease, we used the same kind of technology, except for we didn't use worldwide air transportation, but a food transportation network. And we were able to, identify the outbreak or the district. So that did work.
About 20
minutes. Good. So I can talk.
Any questions on this part, or move on?
Okay. I can now move on. If you have more questions, go on, or otherwise I'll move on to the other type of network that I mentioned earlier. And this falls into this sort of category of experimental epidemiology, which is kind of a weird term if you think about, because one of the things that, you know, we cannot do so well in epidemiology is we cannot, run an experiment, see how an infection happens in a human population. We cannot infect anyone with like sort of a benign virus and see how it spreads. That sort of thing doesn't work. But we can work, we can make a workaround here. This is a project that I wanted to mention. That's a collaboration with Sune Lehmann and Connie Beach mainly, and also Olivia did a lot of work here. She's also been to the SFI a couple of years ago. And this is related to this network that I showed you earlier. And now let me show you this network again. Where is it? It's right here. We load this a little bit. So this is a network of people. Okay, so every little circle is a person. It's actually a student of DTU Copenhagen. And every link represents physical proximity over time. So what Sune did and his team, this is a couple of years ago, they bought like 1,000 cell phones and distributed them to students. And there was a special software on this, and everything that they did was recorded. Where they were, the GPS, their communication on Facebook, their communication by email, their communication by talking to each other on the phone, texting, everything. So it's like this, it was designed as a participatory experiment. All the students knew this. They had sort of they owned the data. They could go out of that experiment at any time, but in Denmark, this is an experiment that would be impossible in Germany, but the Danes are like super open about this, and there you can make such an experiment. And one of the results here is that this is a physical proximity network, so two individuals are close in space when the phones notice this by Bluetooth, and the thickness of these lines quantifies the time they spend together. And you can see this is averaged over a 3-month period. And you can see that there's structure, there are these clusters, friendship groups, there are also couples. Like mostly these people that have these strong links are dating because they spend the nights together. All of this is in the data. You can see breakup of relationships and everything. And all of this is available in the data. Now this is important for epidemiology because many of these infectious diseases are spread by physical contact or physical proximity. So one of the things that we wanted to understand is what is the impact of the structure of these networks on disease dynamics. So I have to go back here and see. So let me tell you a little bit about the data set. It's about measuring face-to-face interactions. And these two guys are sort of behind this this data set, and like I mentioned earlier, they distributed these cell phones to people, and the cell phones detected physical proximity, also their mobility in space. And one of the results that they found is when you take temporal snapshots of these networks, you find generically that, you know, if you just take a snapshot, there are often groups. You know, they can be just pairs, or, you know, aside from the nodes that are isolated, which is the majority, you often you see groups of people. You know, they could be having lunch together, etc., or they could be studying together as a function of time. And so there's always this, they call this gathering structure, which disappears if you average this network over time. And often this structure, let me show you the next slide, which illustrates this. If you average this proximity over an entire day, you get like a fully connected or almost fully connected graph, because everyone sees each other. If you go to a finer resolution, you see these little groups, and they can, there's an own dynamical process that is happening, so people can, you know, leave a group and join another group, or they can isolate themselves, and that has an impact on how diseases spread. And I'll just show this to you in a little qualitative simulation. So right here is, this is just a model system. It's sort of a toy system that is just there to illustrate that sort of group structure and temporality may have an impact on disease dynamics. So what is shown here? So this is a simple disease dynamical model where the red nodes are infected, and they can infect the white ones or the gray ones with a certain probability if there's a link between them. And when they are no longer infectious, they recover and become immune. These are the blue dots. And that is all happening on a very fast time scale. So, you know, in reality, this happens on a much slower time scale. But it's just there to illustrate this. And the immune people, they can become susceptible again after a longer time scale. And what is generic in such a model, that it equilibrates into a system where there's a certain fraction of infected individuals, because the, you know, there are new susceptibles coming in, but because people lose immunity and the infection dynamics, that kind of, that these processes balance. And approximately, you know, in this situation, there are always like 50 individuals infected in this toy system. In addition to this, you see like this network changes over time. So there's some sort of random rewiring. Imagine this is a sort of a well-mixed population. This is what people then call a well-mixed population, because every individual can contact every other individual with the same probability. And then you get like this sort of mixed situation. And when I change this a little bit, this is now a model that we've published that generates automatically these little groups. That is also, the structure is also observed in the, say, the Copenhagen data and other data. And then you can see the dynamics changes quite dramatically. You have like these strongly connected globules here, and whenever there's a disease that hits it, you know, there's going to be sort of a local outbreak, and then some groups totally recover. And what you can show, that, you know, the dynamics of this type of the same kind of dynamical process is strongly impacted by the temporal structure of this network. Even though on a longer time scale this is mixing, you can show that like the extinction threat or the extinction probability is much higher in this sort of system. The fluctuations are much larger. So okay. So what is happening here is, as a function of time, you pick a node randomly, and this node cuts all its links, and then makes a random connection to another node and some other nodes in this globule, and then it gets just pulled over there. It's just sort of a spring layout. So you can just, so the layout, the spatial layout of this has no information. It's just a spring layout that you can see now it just went extinct. Okay, so let me reload this real quick. So initially you have like only susceptibles in white, and yes, the blue ones are recovered and they're immune. And the blue ones stay immune for some time, and then they lose their immunity and become susceptible again. That's called the SIRS model, and it has an equilibrium. And so one of the things that we're doing, and I'm not going to go into detail too much, is we want to figure out, this is a collaboration with Sune. We want to, you know, what we do is we run simulations on this, on these proximity networks that Sune measured in the sample of students. So what you see here is a computer simulation on the actual contact pattern among these students. And the purple curve is what people usually derive, what is available to epidemiologists. They have like information about the incidence or the prevalence of a disease, so they can measure how many people are sick as a function of time. But it's not really what matters for a contagion process of this nature. What matters is the number of links between susceptibles and infected, because these are the things that transmit a disease. And in a well-mixed population, you can compute one from the other, but not in a real situation. And it's very dramatic when you look at this. So this is the epi curve available, you know, the data typically available to epidemiologists, and the green curve is, as a function of time, the number of links between susceptibles and infected. And it's very bursty. There's a strong daily modulation, the circadian rhythm. It's different on the weekend, etc. So this green stuff actually is important to the dynamics. And this is what we have to really model if we want to model this sort of thing. And not so much, you know, this purple curve. And this illustration that I showed you earlier with these sort of flocks that build and we have an epidemic on it, it is really, everything in it can be computed by just looking at the links between susceptibles and infected. So this is the quantity one has to look at. And I think this kind of research where people run simulations on these real data sets is important, but it's also important to, and that's like, you know, people are doing this in baby steps, trying to make models that account for certain features of, you know, of the dynamics of susceptible infected links in real scenarios. And so with that, I want to thank you for your attention. Do I have a review or do I know one?
Or do you know one?
A review article on like computational epidemiology or
the stuff on the random walks and the minimal path and how that.
I can point you to two papers that we have, or three of them actually.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Really interesting.
Yeah. Oh, and actually, chapters too.
Okay.
On those two movies of this dynamics of epidemic and temporal network, what was the difference in parameters? I mean, what parameter makes those two different?
So you mean?
I mean, in one case there was a clustering and
So this one.
Uh-huh.
And this one.
Uh-huh.
This is a dynamic model that we made that naturally leads to these gatherings.
Uh-huh.
I can point you to an archive article about this. It's very simple. So you rewire also randomly. So a node cuts all its links and takes a new target, makes links to it, and with a certain probability also to that node's neighbors. And depending on this probability.
So what do you mean by neighbor here? Is that something like?
A neighbor is a node that I have a link to. So imagine, you know, I cut all my links. Now I'm free, and then I pick a random node. And I make a link to it, then this is my neighbor.
I see.
But that person also has a bunch of links already,
mm-hmm.
potentially.
Mm-hmm.
And then I connect to that person's neighbors.
I see.
So let's say you sit there and I join you for lunch,
mm-hmm.
I will automatically connect also to the people that
I see.
You talk to.
Mm-hmm. It's very interesting because we were working on opinion dynamics in two-click graphs.
Mm-hmm.
I work with Sid Redner here. I'm a postdoc.
Mm-hmm.
We found some interesting features like opinions in two clicks. It's a binary opinion system.
Okay.
If we have sparse connections between clicks, somehow one click reaches one opinion and another click reaches other opinion. So I was a bit curious how.
Yeah,
somehow connection itself changes like this.
Yeah. what sort of rules
naturally drive the system towards such a multi-click graph. Do you see what I'm saying?
Yeah, no, I know exactly what you're saying. So there's an interaction between the opinion dynamics and the and the topology of the
network remodeling. For instance, if myself and you have a difference in opinion, probably you would break my friendship. This kind of scenarios probably would lead to some sort of modular structure.
There are a bunch of articles about this already, I think. It's like this whole adaptive network business.
I see. So you say it's adaptive network, comes under category of adaptive network?
Yeah. It's when the dynamics also has an